1996. It was released in 1997. The thing, Sierra Online called The Trail of Antara. That was really early on in the video game industry. Since then, I've probably been on about 25 different computer games, credited on 18. And I didn't start working for Valve until like 2002, something like that, when they were putting together Half-Life 2. And the interesting one fun story is that they hired me to do the citizens and Odessa Cubbage in Half-Life 2, and then much later in the development of the game, just the way the game was developed, they hired Ellen to do the voice of Overwatch in Half-Life 2. And at that time, they had no idea that we were married, because she goes by Ellen McLain, I go by John Patrick Lowrie. There's no way that they would know. But then, and they didn't know all through Half-Life 2, and then they hired us both to do Team Fortress 2. And one day they scheduled us consecutively on the same day at the studio, and I forget which one of us was first, but that person, I think it was Ellen, said, "Oh, you're going to be working with my husband later." And that was the first time they found out that we were married. Well, then Ellen got famous as GLaDOS, and the fan world started learning that we were married one way or another. And so Valve thought of a very funny joke, and so I don't know if you guys, have you guys played Left 4 Dead?
Yep.
Yes.
In the first one, you make your way through the whole city full of zombies, and you're killing zombies, and you're trying to get out of the city, and you finally make it to the river at the end of the game, and you hear this voice over the radio saying, "Hey, I got a boat, I can pick you up, are there any survivors?" And in the background you hear this woman saying, "Are you nuts? There's zombies everywhere, we're not picking up anybody!" Well, they thought it would be funny if we were the bickering married couple at the end of Left 4 Dead. So that's a little Easter egg, so if you go in and play it again, you'll hear us fighting with each other.
In the studio at the same time to do that, which is sort of unusual.
Yes,
but they actually had us together.
So that we could really bicker.
Yeah.
They figured that we could improv that pretty good. So.
Yeah, he's a much better improviser than I am.
But she's a great bickerer. So.
That's my town.
So, do you guys have any specific questions, anything that you would like to know about what it's like to work in the gaming industry or anything like
or
that?
Or for Val.
Yeah. Yep.
How's it working for Gabe Newell?
I'm sorry?
How's it working under Gabe Newell?
Do you know that I have never met him? I don't know if John has met him.
No, no, no. Uh-uh.
But I, you know.
He wasn't even at the Portal 2
release party.
I mean, I think the guy spends all of his time being rich.
No.
It takes a lot of work.
No.
You know? No, I mean, he's a great guy, and I mean, I can tell you what I've read about him, but I mean, he's the kind of guy who will see a project made by a group of students at DigiPen, and not only say let's turn the project into a game, but I'm going to hire the whole group so that because you guys work together well, I want to keep the team together because you feed off each other's energy. So I'll just hire all four of you, and let's make Portal. And that's the way they did that. And it's that kind of creative thinking and that kind of respect for creativity and respect for just the nature of teamwork and how teams are put together and how they feed off of each other that has, I think, really contributed to Valve's success.
And I think that attitude is pervasive throughout their whole company. Is you always feel he needs his potassium. You always feel like you're part of a team. That I mean, that because they really tell you what's going on, and you hear about their creative process as well, and how the character is developed. You know, as
and Bill Van Buren once told us that you know when they're
he's a producer in fact.
Yeah. I don't. Yeah, we may be referred. Anybody who is like floored by a name that I'm saying doesn't know who I'm talking about, just raise your hand and say who the heck is that. He's the guy that we really work under. He kind of has run Half-Life 2, Team Fortress 2, and Portal 2, and Left 4 Dead. And so he is always in the studio with us and directing us and stuff like that. But he does a lot of the hiring and that stuff at Valve. And he says that their attitude there really is to not fill a position, but find a good person. You know, if they need somebody, they look for somebody. and they look to see what that person does, then they, and if that kind of, is the right kind of person, they hire them, and then they figure out how to create a position for them. So it's really kind of a forward-thinking deal there, and I think it works very well, and they come up with some good product.
Because they found Eric Wolpaw and Chet Folasek. So Eric Wolpaw was the principal writer for Portal, and Portal, not Portal 2, because for Portal 2 it was Eric and Jay Pinkerton. And then for Portal 2, the multiplayer, the principal writer is Chet Folasek. But Eric and Chet worked together on a comedy, I don't know, what would you call it, a comedy podcast, would that be it?
Yeah.
Called Old Man Murray. And Gabe enjoyed the comedy writing of Old Man Murray. So he hired both Eric and Chet. And Eric and Chet are, you know, doing different things in the company, but Gabe found them together on this, you know, podcast blog thing, which I never call things by the right name.
Right. But as far as what the places are like, I mean, we've been out to Valve, and of course, when I worked for Bungie on Halo, Reach and Halo ODST, they do all the recording at Bungie, and when I have recorded for Fear Project Origin, and there's a new Lord of the Rings game coming out, and oh, and there's some other game that I did there, I can't remember right now, but at Monolith, Warner Brothers, all these places, if you can imagine, as gamers, heaven. Where you would like to go when you die. I imagine it would be a big dimly lit room filled with huge LCD screen computers with people playing games on them all the time. And when we went out and toured Valve, because some friends of ours were in town, and we took them out there and showed them around, Valve had just hired a whole bunch of people from the Weta Workshop in New Zealand, including the guy who designed Gollum. And so we got to see the original sculpture of Gollum that they scanned into the computer.
Because he owned it. 3D, you know, it was sitting on his desk.
And, you know, you walk into Bungie, or you walk into Valve, and what you see are, like, you know, life-size and a half statues of their main characters and, like, weapons everywhere, all these, you know, sci-fi weapons, because they actually make models of them. And a lot of them are just created by other people that they send to these places, and they put them in display. So it's wonderful walking around, seeing guys working on 3D rendering, seeing guys working on the Boolean algebra for the actual gameplay, putting together scenery, putting together characters. There are artist renderings all over the walls. The process for the animation is very interesting, because I think that every animator has their own way of working. Some people still work with pen and ink on the first renderings, and then they put them into the computer. Some people work right away on CAD programs. But all these guys are maniacs, and all of them are just like you. You know, they're all just maniacs who love games and got into it and learned how to design them. And it's interesting, I mean, our part of the process really is very discreet. You know, they're all in this kind of rat's maze of computers and rooms and talking to each other all the time. And then when it's time to have these characters actually come to life, they call us in and we just go into a little tiny booth and talk to the microphone.
And as John was saying, you know, the recordings for the Bungie games are always done at Bungie. But the recordings for the Valve games are always done in a studio in Seattle called Pure Audio. And the principal engineers in that studio are Scott Weiss and Steve Hanke, and then the owner of Pure Audio, Paul, and I can't remember his last name, but he owns the company. And it's interesting to me that Valve likes the work of Pure Audio so much that the voice actors always go to Pure Audio. And then they take the recordings, Valve takes the recordings and, you know,
well, it's interesting. Yeah. I mean, I think it's interesting. Each game company kind of has their own philosophy and their own budget. Valve decides to farm out the recording engineering work to Pure Audio. Bungie and Monolith both do it's just kind of a, what do they want to spend the money on? How do they want to spend it?